teenage boy slips away from a youth group meeting one evening and enters the sanctuary of the church. It's a large and long space, hushed and utterly dark. The silence is so intense that he can hear himself breathing as he moves forward on a carpeted aisle. He feels something akin to fear, but it is not that harm will come to him. It is fear that something out of his control will happen, something both good and terrible. It seems as if there is something or someone waiting for him in the dark, a mysterious presence whose house he feels this surely is. He stops his forward progress, utters a distracted prayer, and then with a shudder slips out the sanctuary door, relieved to hear his friends' voices and to see the fluorescent lighting. Was anything there? Was it just adolescent fear of the dark? The boy, now an adult, doesn't know. But if he had that moment back again, he would want to launch great gushing shouts of prayer into that dark and push his body forward to whatever encounter lay ahead. First Nations people have a long tradition of sending their young men out into the woods alone on spirit quests. They are sent to find their path to the future through encounter with a spiritual power that is beyond their control, and yet that will become something like a guardian angel to them in all the years to come. Anthropologists tell us that such quests are common amongst tribal peoples, and that what is sought is liminality, a state of being in which fasting and solitariness make the initiates radically open to the power of the divine to shape their identity and send them on their way. If you will, encounters arising in a spirit quest are epiphanies, surprising events, even astonishing ones, all experiences in some sense of the holy. And up on the Mount of Transfiguration, the three disciples who have accompanied Jesus certainly have an epiphany. They see their teacher suddenly bathed in glory, an uncreated light making his clothing luminous and his face radiant. They see him conversing with two monumental figures of Israel's past, Moses, the giver of the law, and Elijah, the quintessential prophet. Then comes the cloud overshadowing them. The vision on the mountaintop is so awesome that it leaves them speechless for months. They will not speak of it again until Jesus is raised from the dead. The Bible is full of accounts of epiphanies. Moses confronted with a burning bush that will not be consumed. Elijah on the run, hiding in a cave, and first comes the earthquake, and then the wind, and then the fire, and at last, almost giving up, he hears the voice he needs to hear in the sheer sound of silence. Mary, visited by an angel who comes bringing unbelievable, scarcely believable news to her. Paul on the road to Damascus, struck blind and hearing a voice that he has never heard before. Such encounters with the holy defy exhaustive analysis and rational explanation. Frequently enough, we think of the holy as a moral category. Someone is holy if she leads a blameless, self-giving life. Negatively, we say that someone is holier than thou if he thinks himself morally superior to others. Forget your perfect offering. But in the Bible, the holy is the realm of the sacred, and holiness is preeminently the defining characteristic of God. It is, if you will, the very godness of God that is described by our word, holy. Holy, 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 only thou art holy. After the First World War, when the cracks and the gaping holes in the liberal modernist doctrine of uninterrupted progress were all too evident, the First World War left so much in Europe in tatters. When such cracks and gaping holes were so obvious, a German theologian by the name of Rudolf Otto lifted up for fresh consideration the idea of the holy. As Otto saw it, there was a serious problem that was infecting Western so-called civilization: its unwarranted confidence in what humans can reduce to the size and shape of their own understanding. And above all, this was true of God, whom humans then and now try to pare down to dimensions that we can accommodate. Recall Alexander Pope, English poet of the 18th century, who was mortified by the casual way in which pedestrian traffic passed through the transepts of St. Paul's Cathedral. Now, the transepts of a church building are the arms of the cross in a building that is cruciform. And set right in the middle, at the center of the shaft of the cross and the arms that are the transepts, would be the high altar where the communion table would be placed. Well, two streets surrounded St. Paul's Cathedral, and they still surround the cathedral today. And to get from one street to the other, it was quicker in the 18th century with the doors of the transepts open to go right through the transepts from one to the other. And so it came about that hurrying people passed right by the Lord's table without giving it a thought. Pope said, "Fools rush in where angels fear to tread." For his part, Otto reminded his hearers that what the Hebrews had in their faith was not simply concepts of God, but startling experience of God that could not be contained in abstract rational constructs. Wonder and worship do not usually spring forth from reasoned consideration, but from hair-raising or heart-warming experiences, encounters of the creature with one who is incontestably Lord of all, the Holy One. And maybe this explains why Peter's bright idea for a theme park doesn't seem to gain any traction. Having seen the vision of Jesus transfigured and joined by Moses and Elijah, he's exuberant. Lord, let's build 3 shrines here. One for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. And he's thinking, of course, with these shrines, people will come year after year, decade after decade, to remember this glorious event. Peter wants to bring this stupendous event into understandable human control. There is in the human religious instinct a propensity to try to domesticate God. How understandable. Karl Barth once said with provocative accuracy that religion is humanity's last defense against God. This year, the Stratford Shakespearean Festival come to Ontario. This year, the Stratford Shakespearean Festival will bring to the stage a dramatization of C.S. Lewis's wonderful children's novel, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. In Lewis's book, readers are introduced to the land of Narnia, held in thrall to the White Witch, whose wicked control is such that it is always winter, but never Christmas. What a mean trip. Certainly, for those of us who live in places where real winter comes, that would be a very mean trick. And 4 children, 2 sons of Adam and 2 daughters of Eve, had gained entry into Narnia through a wardrobe where they meet strange creatures, animals who can talk, and they are informed by Mr. and Mrs. Beaver about someone who is coming to deliver Narnia from its misery, Aslan. The children are startled to learn that Aslan is not a human, but a lion. As Mrs. Beaver puts it, he is the great lion, son of the emperor beyond the sea. And the children are anxious as they think about meeting a lion, and they ask, is he safe? Safe, says Mrs. Beaver. Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. He's the king, I tell you. Later in the story, when the children glimpse Aslan for the first time, with his golden mane and his great solemn eyes, they can't meet his gaze and they tremble. And the narrator observes, people who have not yet been in Narnia sometimes think that a thing cannot be good and terrible at the same time. Good and terrible at the same time. That's a stretch, isn't it? But it's a stretch worth making. Think of just one thing. The beautiful phrase in the Song of Solomon, when the lover describes the beauty of his beloved in this way. Who is this who looks forth like the dawn, fair as the moon, bright as the sun, terrible as an army with banners? Yes, if one's heart is full of love and longing, and the beauty of the other seems beyond one's scope and one's hope, the presence of the beloved coming toward one could indeed be terrible as an army with banners. The disciples find the experience of Jesus transfigured in light and conversing with Moses and Elijah and then being overshadowed by the cloud terrifying. And yet it is good. It is exalting. It provides vital insight into the identity and destiny of Jesus. The presence of Moses and Elijah is testimony to the fact that Jesus is more than another lawgiver or another prophet. As God's Messiah, he is the fulfiller of all that the law and the prophets ever pointed to. And the disciples hear the voice confirming the meaning of what they had seen and heard. This is my son, the chosen. Listen to him. And the conversation among Moses, Elijah, and Jesus, they are talking about his departure. In the Greek text, which our English translations translate, the word departure translates the word exodus. And the exodus that Jesus will take at Jerusalem will involve his death and resurrection. That's what they are talking about. Jesus will depart the earth by fulfilling his destiny as a Messiah who will empty himself to the point of death upon a Roman cross to bring about the salvation of many. That Jesus is uniquely child of God, God's chosen, God's beloved, and not merely another martyr, another lawgiver, another prophet is underscored when the three disciples look and no longer see Moses and Elijah, but Jesus only. It's terrifying for the disciples on the Mount of Transfiguration, and it will be terrifying on the Mount of Golgotha, where their master and friend will die. But believers have come to remember that day as Good Friday. For God was doing something awesome there and good. The event of the cross of Jesus, like the transfiguration of Jesus, is shrouded and luminous with the holiness of God. Dare we open ourselves to such mystery, mystery that transcends our ability to express, and yet that lifts us up in wonder and awe. It is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Holy One, loving God, you give us treasure after treasure in the book that reads us. You show us the shape of our frailty and of our failure. You give freedom and forgiveness for past folly. You bless us with remembrance of our better selves. You call us anew to a life worth living. You humble us and fill us with joy in the presence of your Christ. Let the light that is your glory in Christ shine on us today. Let the shining of Jesus' face lift us in gratitude and hope. Let your love fill our hearts.